share with you. First of all, it's Youth Sunday, and it's not probably a good idea to do Youth Sunday on the time change, just saying. But, I mean, just to have the kids here is unbelievable. I said it feels like 6:15. They got here at 7:15, and it feels like 6:15. It feels like 7 o'clock right now, too, doesn't it? Anyhow, but just appreciate them so very, very much. And you'll be blessed this morning. It's a unique service that we're going to share with you today. I love the fact that when it comes to our church history, liturgy, music, everything, there's such diversity over time. We're going to share something today, the Te Deum, that dates back to 368, and then we're going to share a contemporary song that's about 3 weeks old. And I just think that's neat. That's kind of fun. But just a couple announcements. Council meeting Monday night at 6 o'clock in the upper room. And Wednesday night, you do not want to miss. Come for dinner Wednesday night. Join us, hamburgers and hot dogs. And Nikki Hardy is going to be here. Her book is on sale in the Narthex. She's got a great sense of humor, a great speaker, a great British accent, by the way. But join with us Wednesday night for this. And she is a cancer survivor and just has a marvelous story to tell. So join with us for that on Wednesday night for our Lenten service. And let's see. Just a couple things to share with you about the service. First of all, we are going to have communion around the rail. So come forward as we do, all the way to the back, and kneel at the rail as you are able to do that. That would be great. And I know Olivia has, yes, a word to share as well. And this is related to Wednesday night, actually.
Didn't we?
Yes.
Yeah.
So we found out really, really fast that there is a definite need in the community for that. Not just our Mount Vista family, but friends of friends. So here's one of our brochures, and we'll actually give these to everyone on Wednesday night. If you want one of these now, after service, please see. Also, there's already cards out there. Please let us know. If you don't want anybody to know, only one of us is going to see this card and one other. So two of us and Pastor Mark. So we will not tell if you do not want us to tell. And then actually have that on the bottom of the card. If it's confidential and you do not want anybody else to know. Because we know that's important. So if it's for any kind of cancer, across the board. And we the bags are great. When we took them to the people who, you know, have already got the bags, they just love them. They lit up. They're using them. They're texting me saying, hey, we love the crossword puzzles, or we love the journals. We're keeping notes. We're, you know, who can I thank? We're like, you can thank God. So that's the only reason that bag right there is God. So we thank him first. We thank you guys at Mount Vista for getting it. I know Pastor Mike says that a lot. We get it. Yep. We want to help others. So please nominate people. And if you want a brochure, let me know.
Thank you all for listening to God. That's marvelous. It's going to be a great ministry. Already is, so thank you.
One of our young people is celebrating her 14th birthday today, and she got here at, well, it felt like 6:15 anyway. Taylor Roseman is out there. Come on out here. She's going to shoot me. Oh, well, it's all right. Can we sing happy birthday? Now you're really going to shoot me, huh? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Taylor. Happy birthday to you. All right, thank you. Just a couple notes about our service as we begin. We'll have a prayer, and then we'll begin with the Agnus Dei, which means Lamb of God. And it's Latin, and it sounds like it's old, and it is. And it's been around for quite a while. As we, in worship, we forget so often that we're here to give honor and thanks and praise, and even to sacrifice ourselves to the one who sacrificed himself for us on the cross, the Lamb of God. And so what our youth will do and feel free to sing everything as you see it on the screen. Please do so. And the lights will be dark. That always helps us Lutherans to sing, because then nobody knows where it's coming from. Anyhow, but to feel free to sing the songs as you see them up on the screen. And remember, as Paul says in Romans 12, he says, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as living sacrifices, which is your spiritual worship. Sunday morning we come to sacrifice ourselves and to give thanks to God for his sacrifice. Right after that, I'll be sharing what's called the Te Deum. That dates back to 368 A.D. Wow. God's been hearing these words from his people for almost 2,000 years. We'll share that. It's divided in parts, women and men. We'll say that nice and loud, if we will, but we're speaking it to God, and I think you'll be blessed by that. It really, as you will see, incorporates what we share in the Apostles' Creed. Let us pray. Lord, today we come to you in worship, giving ourselves to you in honor of your sacrifice. We sacrifice ourselves in praise and worship. This day, today, our entire focus is not on the world, not on ourselves, not what we can get, but what we can give in praise and worship to you. Help us to give ourselves and dedicate and consecrate this time to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. would please stand? Women begin.
You are God, and we praise you. You are the Lord, and we acclaim you.
You are the eternal Father. All creation worships you. Cherubim and seraphim sing in endless praise.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory.
The glorious company of apostles praise you.
The noble fellowship of prophets praise you.
The white-robed army of martyrs praise you.
Throughout the whole world, the holy church acclaims you. Your true and only Son, worthy of all worship.
And the Holy Spirit, advocate and guide.
You, Christ, are the King of glory.
The eternal Son of the Father.
When you became man to set us free.
And opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers.
You are seated at God's right hand in glory. Come then, Lord, and help your people.
Bought with the price of your own blood.
And bring us with your saints to glory everlasting.
Holy Word.
seated. We all know in Genesis, the creation story, that in the beginning, God created everything. 6 days, and then Shabbat, and then Sabbath. And we also know that God said that everything is good. The only thing that he didn't say was good was the man that he created. And before the women get all excited, he said that it was not good because he didn't have a mate, didn't have a helper. And then he created, of course, Eve. We're familiar with that story. You know, it's the first article of the Apostles' Creed talking about how God is the creator. And it's absolutely fantastic to think about, but it is not enough. To know that God is the creator. To know that God is all-powerful, all-present, and all-knowing is fantastic. But we would be lost if that's all that there was. We'd be worshiping a superhero. We have to know the rest, the second and the third articles, that who we worship is a God who is absolutely all-loving. Perhaps first and foremost, we realize that. That's why John in his gospel said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. The Word, Jesus, who later in Colossians we hear about, holds all things together in his love. It means absolutely everything in the world to realize that the Creator subjects himself to his creation and love for us in order to save us. On all the hills of this earth that he created, one hill in particular, he made for him to die on a cross for us, to show how much love he has for us. Watch this.
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time, with no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of life. And that you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath. The planets form. If the stars were made to worship so loud, I can see your heart. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises so loud. So am I. God of your promise. Speak in vain, no syllable empty, oh boy. For once you have spoken, nature and science follow the sound of your voice. And as you speak, see you. You speak, 100 billion failures disappear. Well, you lost your life so I could find it here. If you left the grave behind you so
can anything separate us from the love that Christ has for us? Stepping from the throne, he removed his robe of light and wrapped himself in skin, pigmented human skin. The light of the universe entered a dark, wet womb. He who angels worship nestled himself in the placenta of a peasant, was birthed into the cold night, and then slept on cow's hay.
Mary did not know whether to give him milk or to give him praise, but she gave him both since he was, as near as she could figure, hungry and holy. Joseph didn't know whether to call him Junior or Father, but in the end they called him Jesus, since that's what the angel said, and since he didn't have the faintest idea what to name a God he could cradle in his arms.
Don't you think their heads tilted and their minds wondered, what in the world are you doing, God? Or better phrased, God, what are you doing in the world? Can anything make me stop loving you? God asks. Watch me speak your language, sleep on your earth, and feel your hurt. Behold the maker of sight and sound as he sneezes, coughs, and blows his nose. You wonder if I understand how you feel? Look into the dancing eyes of the kid in Nazareth. That's God walking to school. Ponder the toddler at Mary's table. That's God spilling his milk.
You wonder how long my love will last. Find your answer on a splintered cross in a craggy hill. That's me, you see up there, your maker, your God, nails stabbed and bleeding, covered in spit and sin-soaked. That's your sin I'm feeling. That's your death I'm dying. That's your resurrection I'm living. That's how much I love you.
Can anything come between you and me as the firstborn son? Hear the answer and stake your future on the triumphant words of Paul. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor ruling spirits, nothing now, nothing in the future, no powers, nothing above us, nothing below us, nor anything else in the whole world will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
You know, wherever Jesus is, lives are absolutely transformed and changed. In fact, you could even say that history itself totally and completely changed. And I don't mean just through redemption and salvation when Jesus came, but also you could draw a line historically before Christ and after Christ. History, even secular history, changed. All of a sudden, instead of one nation warring against another nation, empires growing just because they could grow, just because might was right, all of a sudden after Christ comes, people start asking for the first time, is this okay? We started talking about just war and things like that. Can we go and do this or not? For the very first time, you can draw a line and see historically. Women before Jesus came were treated completely different than after he came, considered just to be property. And all of a sudden, as Jesus comes and he has women followers, gives them positions of leadership, and the Apostle Paul takes off from them, all of a sudden you can draw a line and realize that Jesus' presence even changes history. And it certainly changes each and every one of us in our encounter with him. Today we hear about a Pharisee named Nicodemus. Now, Pharisees get a real bum rap, you know what I mean? As the legalists, the religious ones, the ones that just are really, really heavy on the law and stuff. And some of that is well-deserved, but listen to this. It was believed in Nicodemus' day that if all of Israel, if all the people of God were good and obeyed the law, just for one day, Messiah would come. Explains a little bit more for their religious fervor, though, to make sure that everybody minds their P's and Q's. Just for one day, let's all just do this. How do you think that went for them? How would it go for us as individuals to be perfect? I mean, just one day, you know. And we're told that Nicodemus came to Jesus at night. And we know why. Because it wasn't a popular thing. Jesus was popular with the common people, but the religious leaders were questioning his every move. My dad used to say that whenever somebody was coming home at 2 in the morning, they probably weren't coming home from Bible study, you know? But Nicodemus is kind of going to a Bible study. He's going, maybe it's 2 o'clock in the morning, to Jesus. Where did they meet? We don't know. But the very fact that Jesus said, yes, let's do that, it's really pretty cool when you think about it. 2 o'clock in the morning, you can't sleep. Don't count sheep. Talk to your shepherd. He's more than willing and able to hear. So what happens in this encounter? Just envision them across the table, a candle between the two of them, and they're talking, and Nicodemus has questions. Of course he does. And unlike the other Pharisees who were questioning Jesus to try to trick him, Nicodemus has honest, heartfelt questions. He says, Jesus, he calls him rabbi, teacher, which is the greatest of compliments. And he says to him, we've seen all that happens when you're around and all the things that happen. Surely it must mean that God is present. And then Jesus says to him, yes. And he says to him, you must be born from above in order to see the kingdom. And Nicodemus says to him, born again, born from above. Does that mean I need to be born in my mother's womb again, start all over again? And Jesus says, no, Nicodemus. How is it that you a teacher of Israel can misconstrue so much? How can I tell you about things of the spirit if you can't even understand things in the physical, material world? And Jesus says to him that the spirit blows where it will. We've had windy days the last couple of days, and you know what that's all about. It really, really does. There's no controlling it. You pretty much have to surrender to it. You see, Nicodemus was a religious lawyer. Besides the Ten Commandments, he had over 600 other things added to all that stuff. He was a guy who would dot his I's and cross his T's, everything in its place, a place for everything, and this is just how it went. All in control, as much as you can possibly do. And Jesus says that's not how the Spirit works. You got to surrender. You got to give up to the Spirit. And then Jesus says, so certainly you know the Old Testament. You know the story about Moses when he's in the wilderness with his people. And they raise up the serpent, the snake on the post. And all the people are healed. And he said, so the Son of Man will be raised up and will draw all people to himself. And then Jesus said familiar words. They're so familiar that I'm afraid we don't pay much attention. But listen to this. These words were totally changed for me when I understood them in a little different context. For God so loved, what? The world, that he gave what? His only Son, who will not perish but have eternal life. Whoever believes in him might not perish but have eternal life. They're so familiar. We see them at football games, you know, people holding up the posters and everything else. But it takes on a whole different emphasis when you realize it's not necessarily just John writing in his gospel a historical fact. But across the table, Jesus is saying this to Nicodemus. Maybe reaching out his hand to Nicodemus and saying, Nicodemus, God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. And maybe he's pointing to himself at that time. Wow. So Nicodemus, who's all wound up and trying to do everything himself and beating himself up because it's just not happening. I just can't myself even be perfect for one day so the Messiah will come. How can I possibly get the people of God, the people of Israel, to do it for one day? Jesus is saying, if he's really listening, let me do this for you. You're looking at the Messiah who is perfect for all of eternity. And if you believe in me, you will not perish but have eternal life. Well, if his eyes aren't welling up a little bit with tears about then Jesus continues with another verse that we just don't read too much. Jesus says to him, for the Son of Man came not to judge and condemn, but to save and to share eternal life. Judging and condemning. Strictness, regulations, rules, laws, mean speaking. How do you speak to yourself? How do you think Nicodemus spoke to himself? Probably pretty rough on himself. You know, God, I just don't measure up. I just can't do this right. I just can't do what I'm supposed to do. As hard as I try, I can't. And all of a sudden, he gets the freedom of realizing he has a Savior who's going to do it for him, just like he does for us. I don't know if you do this or not, but when I pray, I love to have music going on sometime too. And if you were sitting in my car, you'd be amazed how loud it gets. I'm cranking this stuff up, you know what I mean? And I wouldn't ask Tony to do this on this next song because it might blow the speakers. But anyhow, there is a new song out called Speak Jesus, and it's absolutely marvelous. It's a prayer song, and it is, I think, exactly what Nicodemus experiences across the table with Jesus. He experiences one, the only one who has the right to judge him and condemn him, says, I don't. I love you. And he speaks words of gentleness and forgiveness and love. How about if we speak Jesus to ourselves, to our family, to this world? It will certainly change everything.
just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom, I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name Jesus over fear and all anxiety. To every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name.
Peace of the Lord be with you all. Let us share his peace. Peace. Peace, y'all. Peace. We'll do that, I guess. Peace, man. Peace, I guess we're fit. Yeah, we are. Peace. Peace the Lord. Is that thing working all right?
Yeah, it's working much better.
On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus gave thanks, took bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, And he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Thank you.
and speak Jesus' words of grace and love to all. Amen.
Shine upon you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Time has
join us Wednesday night if you can. And also just a brief parent meeting about camps right after service. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.